Hello and welcome to The Hard Sell, the show where the candy cane in the hat box... No, never mind. I don't think Freddie Mercury has ever been quoted with such sincerity as this. Thank God it's Christmas. Because that means we're at the end of a particularly godforsaken year. There have been some horrible ones lately, but 2020 was the first to outdo the often literal death march that was 2016. 2016 was like a Nightmare on Elm Street movie, a combination of slasher film, as almost everyone you ever admired keeled over dead, sometimes for no reason at all, and absurdist horror, as every worst-case scenario came true, also often senselessly and after seeming literally impossible. By comparison, 2020 was pure Stephen King. There was a stand, obviously, and is it just me who was expecting the makers of the new adaptation to wait until it's a bit less like a documentary? There was misery. God, there was misery. As we all spent much of the time locked up in our own homes, with reality itself playing the Kathy Bates role. And there was It, as a demented clown bent on doing nothing but evil staggered across the landscape before being seemingly defeated but not destroyed. Let's skip chapter 2 where he comes back and turns into a spider, please. So yeah, it's been a bit of a year. One of those ones that historians, if any, will look back on and shake their heads, puff their cheeks out and say, "Welp." And the advertising for the Christmas season that represents the cork in the bottle of this particular vintage can't help but reflect that. Most of the big festive adverts this year make some kind of reference to the plague and the quarantine, all that good stuff that was supposed to be over by now, but oops, we decided a year ago that competent government was the last thing we wanted, and now for some reason we're surprised that everything is fucked up, including things we didn't even know about back then, and whether... Sorry. Goodwill to all men. The point is that the plague is still here, and unavoidable, for some reason, and the adverts reflect that. The real question becomes what aspect of the plague world they'll highlight. John Lewis and their advert are so much an essential part of Christmas at this point that it's not even remarked upon anymore. Although, to be fair, there were one or two other distractions when this year's advert was launched. And their effort this year, which of course does double duty as a Waitrose advert since they synergised their brands a couple of years ago, yeah, goes for the We're All Linked community spirit angle, both in the narrative and in the production of the advert itself, which consists of a linked game of consequences illustrated by several different filmmakers and animators. Preeminent ones, like Chris Hopewell and Sylvain Chomet, that only John Lewis could afford. Meanwhile, the terrific up-and-coming singer Celeste provides the de rigueur, sad, breathy piano-led soundtrack.
Of all the things to be, I choose the kindness, and if you gave some to me, I think we'd find ourselves here dancing in the street. Everyone we meet would smile a little daydream. It could be amazing, wouldn't it be wonderful if everybody gave a little love? already gained a little love. If I give this gift to you, wouldn't everybody gain?
As a bonus, and this hasn't been true of every previous John Lewis Christmas ad, there's plenty of actual name-dropping of the store, or rather stores themselves. Last year's one, you recall, was set in the fantasy Middle Ages, so didn't really have the opportunity, and nor did the one about Sir John Elton, or the trampolining dog. What does it say, that it's actually a bonus when these adverts are able to allude to the actual product they're advertising? Well, nothing important. Where John Lewis have made up for live-action filming becoming awkward by making extensive use of animation, M&S have just shrugged and accepted it. What with lockdown and all, not to mention falling profits, they've scaled down to just the basics. The now classic method of close-ups of food, accompanied as ever by the late Peter Green's albatross, narrated by famous people. 9 of them, apparently, including Olivia Colman, Julie Walters, Naomi Harris, and Jeremy Zion.
Oh, what a year. Let's try to make Christmas a little brighter, shall we? Oh, what a great place to start. The Light Globe Gin Liqueur with edible gold leaf. Gosh, I don't know whether to drink it or put it on top of the tree. What's this? Our best ever smoked salmon, smoked over oak and chestnut. Wow, these are a little bit fancy pants. Collection mini beef and porcini Yorkshires. Slow cooked beef, creamy mushroom with a garlic and herb crumb. Oh, the big finale, the triple chocolate panettone. Come on, a bit closer. Come on, don't be shy. That's it. Dark chocolate, chocolate sauce and white chocolate chips because, well, because Christmas. This is not just Christmas food. This is M&S Christmas food.
Each one coming with a little note to say M&S have donated to their chosen charities, which is nice.
Cheese. Man's greatest invention. 3-year-old Cornish cruncher vintage cheddar with its subtle crunch. Ooh. Collection luxury truffle brie. Soft and creamy with rich black truffle. Can you imagine Christmas without delicious cheese? It's enough to give you nightmares. This is not just cheese. This is M&S cheese.
Auntie Naomi is supporting Youth Theatre and Africa's first STEM school for girls, for example. Jeremy's gone with the Irish Air Ambulance and a charity that rescues street children in India. While Olivia's chosen Anthony Nolan, plus spinal cords and domestic abuse. So that's nice. Unfortunately, even Julie Walters can't sell the chicken donut that M&S, in a fit of confusion, apparently thinking they were Iceland, have invented this year.
Ha! Now I've seen everything. Succulent chicken breast with waffle crumb sprinkles. The chicken donut dipper. Well, if a chicken donut doesn't excite you, nothing will.
There's a few problems I can think of with that statement. Their non-food business, meanwhile, is keeping faith with live action, albeit socially distanced.
Christmas. It's on.
One way or another, I'm gonna see ya. I'm gonna meet ya, meet ya, meet ya, meet ya one day. Maybe next week, I'm gonna meet ya. I'm gonna meet ya, I'll meet ya.
Clearly counting on the adorability of Holly Willoughby to see them through, in lieu of anything more elaborate. And it is a rich vein, let's face it. Tesco are choosing to invoke the entire world's complete and utter exhaustion with this entire bloody year, with their whole no naughty list premise.
I gave my sister a really terrible haircut. What if I'm on the naughty list?
Relax. After this year, Tesco says there is no naughty list. So take that, Kay. You deserve it.
I may have bought too many loo rolls.
So did I.
And me.
I once forgot to sing happy birthday when I washed my hands.
I didn't teach them physics or maths.
Or geography.
Guys, it's fine. There's no naughty list, so tuck in.
I didn't do it to catch some Tom.
What?
No.
I did do a charity bake-off.
Whew!
I might have gone on holiday.
Oh, Santa. Well, have a mince pie. And Britain, you have all the treats you want, OK? Because this year at Tesco, there is no naughty list.
They've actually gone into a bit of trouble for this. Not because it's strained, grating, and ultimately rather patronising. No, from hand-wringing parents, who have yelled at Tesco for removing the annual threat of Santa's wrath and thereby giving their kids apparent carte blanche to do whatever they like all the time forever. Because it's not as if they, their parents, could do anything about it whatsoever. Raise your damn kids, you absolute cock... Sorry. Again. It's been that kind of a year, right? And nothing sums up where we all are right now than the other controversies over Christmas adverts this year. Sainsbury's are invoking that old Dunkirk spirit or whatever, with a series of deliberately lo-fi vignettes depicting Christmas in lockdown and how, hey, it's still Christmas, fuck the virus.
Hey.
Hey, it's me.
Oh, hey, love.
How are you? How's Mum?
Yeah, well, we're fine. We're all good, we're good.
I'm getting so excited for Christmas.
Christmas! I just really hope I can see you.
Me too, I cannot stop thinking about Mum's roasties.
Whoa. What about my gravy?
What about your gravy?
Hey, you, what's going down?
Dad, not the song.
Gravy boat, coming in town. Oh. It's not any old ship, just take a sip.
Dad.
It's filled with scrummy and so safe bits.
How does Mum put up with you? Your gravy is pretty good, to be fair, and I just really want to be home for it.
So my gravy is the best.
Dad.
Honey! She says my gravy's the best! Honey!
Morrison's are doing something similar, but more subtle, with a Dua Lipa soundtrack instead of explicitly referring to the pandemic itself.
Now we'll look back at 2020.
Making Christmas special.
All very nice and smiley, if not particularly memorable or original. Not that you should be coming to adverts for memorability or originality in the first place. But controversial. Oh yes. Because you see, black people... That's it. There are black people. And homosexual gays in the Morrison's one. Proving beyond a shadow of a doubt that these companies despise white people and would see them subtly wiped out via adverts like these, which subtly indoctrinate the population of Britain into thinking that black people and homosexuals are perfectly normal and have a right to exist. The whole issue is far too depressing to dwell on any further, especially in a Christmas episode. You wouldn't think it would be too hard to find something uplifting in a festive Christmas special, would you? I know, how about Debenhams?
Throw it up, give out the cheer, cause it's our favourite time of year. Give a gift that shows you care, that brings a smile you both can share. Gift a loved one, gift a mate, gift for Mum, Dad, Steve and Kate. A gift for when they dance about, a gift to give that perfect pal. Come on and make some Christmas magic, double click and feel giftastic.
Well, that's cheerful and everything. Oh, but Debenhams are all but dead, so this is probably the last advert they'll ever make. The only hope is Mike Ashley. Doesn't really count as a last hope, does he? Alright, how about Amazon? Ignoring the fact that they're the worst company in the world to work for and won't pay their taxes. Maybe the advert at least is Holly Jolly or something.
The star of the winter show is...
Good evening. All schools across the country will close by the end of the week until further notice as coronavirus reached out.
God damn it, it's poignant and tear-jerking. Asta?
What is he up to now?
You right, Christine? I guess Christmas is going to be different this year, so let's really make the most of it.
Oh, they're still using this fake proletarian. I can make a better advert than you, tosser mascot.
It's the Christmas we all need, at the prices we all want. What do you think, Christine?
Oh, nice. When's it coming down?
That's an Asda prize Christmas.
So at least it's not depressing. Just irritating.
Look, a shooting star. It must be Christmas. It's not Christmas until Daddy gets home.
Talking of which, the worst thing about Kevin the Carrot is that I don't like him. And he makes me feel guilty that I don't like him. Because he's fundamentally harmless. In fact, more than that, he's fundamentally benevolent and positive. But that's the problem. Like Sprout Boy from BBC One's Christmas Idents from 2015, he's cute, positive and non-threatening in a way that's incredibly transparent. Like he's so calculated, I can practically see the equations running under his high-fibre carrot-peel skin. The artificiality, the mechanicalness is too obvious. The mechanism is too visible. He might be CGI, but I can still see the strings.
The world is hushed and white with snow. Lonely hearts meet through a window.
Well, here we go again.
Put a friendship
in your
head.
No.
Huh?
It's a Christmas ad from Lidl with great prices instead.
Finally, some pushback. Lidl are reminding us all that adverts for shops used to just be a case of showing the product, showing the price, showing the shop's logo, and leaving.
British turkey, smell the magic. A jumper with our logo and a pig in a blanket. Great value parsnips, oh what a price. Emotional gravy, that potato looks nice. We don't need cutesy characters when carrots taste this good.
We don't want romance, we want award-winning Christmas pod. There's usually a moment where we want you to feel sad. We don't have time for sparkling wine. This cheese will make you feel so glad.
It's a magical time of year.
For all the Christmas magic, hidden cake and sprouts and gin. Have a little way big on a Christmas you can believe in.
This advert is well overdue, quite frankly. One that's deliberately and vocally rejecting the emotionally manipulative conventions that have sprung up in the past decade to the point of cliché and burnout. It's just a shame that it's come now, in 2020, at the end of the painful apocalyptic plague year, when just this once, at least I hope it's just this once, most of us actually kind of want the kind of reassurance that the John Lewis advert gives us. And never forget, of course, that in its own way, this is just as cynical as the adverts it's parodying. It's manipulating and pandering to your emotions in exactly the same way. It's just that it's aiming at your ironic self-congratulatory glands instead of your tear ducts. Don't feel bad, it's what adverts do. Just don't let yourself forget it. So what else? Oh, Coca-Cola. Well, that's hardly likely to provide any relief from the relentless pessimism and cynicism of 2020, is it? More of that dystopian horror with the fleet of trucks passing by so people can literally stand in awe of their corporate gods and masters, I expect. Oh, hang on, it says here they've hired Taika Waititi to direct. The guy behind the last Thor film, and What We Do in the Shadows. And that thing with the kid whose imaginary friend was Hitler. And he played Hitler. So it should be interesting, at least. Well, fairly standard so far. Father leaves sad little girl at Christmas. She gives him a letter to Santa. And oh no, he forgot to send it. So now it's going to be a quest structure, I imagine, as he tries to get the letter to K. Nicholas Kringle's house in time. This is all very exciting, well shot and expensive looking. Not to mention correctly socially distanced, if only since there's only one person in 95% of the shots. But I feel like it's lost the Coca-Cola thread somewhere. Here we go, those bloody trucks. And obviously he drives him home in the truck and the Christmas lights light up and it's all the usual corporate bollocks. Just needs I'd like to teach the world to sing to make it complete. Well, son of a bitch. I don't know how Waikiki did it, but he did it. It works. The damn thing works. That should be as corny a punchline as you'd find on any sub-John Lewis heartstrings clutching campaign, but I'll be goddamned if it doesn't successfully jerk the tears. Congratulations, you magnificent bastard. Sure you couldn't work Hitler into it somewhere, though. Other than that, pretty much perfect. And a good thing, too, because now I think we can safely say the acme has been reached. There's no topping this one. There's no point trying, so stop. And we can all move on to a different aesthetic next Christmas, if there is one. Here's hoping, anyway, because the world is depressing enough right now without us being gently kicked in the bollocks by our advertisers. Christmas is supposed to be the decompression chamber. The 1 week off where you're allowed to not give a fuck about anything. It's the original Purge, except without the violence. I mean, that's the flaw with that film series. Well, one of the flaws. There's no need to legalise crime for a night. We've already got an entire week of the year where we legalise self-indulgence. And that works out fine. I don't know, maybe we should make it into a fortnight. Enjoy yourselves, in a safe, masked, socially distant sort of a way, of course. Don't do anything stupid. Every Christmas is last Christmas. Nadelic Clowen. You've been watching a Bob the Fish production. Thanks! If you haven't found it already, be sure to check out our website at bobthefish.org.uk. Literally hundreds of videos not unlike this one that will make you laugh, think and realise new things or your money back. Which works out great because they're all absolutely free. All of this is possible thanks to the not unique way that Bob the Fish productions are paid for by you, the viewing public, via Patreon. For a donation of as little as £1 a month, not only do you ensure that I still have food and shelter so I can carry on making these programs, but you could become eligible for a whole host of cool extras. New video essays, special event live streams, all my content a week in advance, and my book on the history of the BBC, Rule the Waves, chapter by chapter as it's written. And some cake, if you go out and buy a cake and eat it while you're watching. And if you don't want to support on a monthly basis, you can make a one-off donation via Ko-fi. It all helps stave off scurvy. bobthefish.org.uk. You make it what it is.